The GOP has selected a speaker, kind of. We'll see. There's a lot of infighting following the closed door conference vote that Scalise ultimately prevailed in. And I want to be extra clear here. This was just a vote amongst Republican members of the House. This did not make him speaker. It simply made him their nominee to be speaker. And let's get into a little bit more of the facts on this from the New York Times. Republicans voted behind closed doors 113 to 99. Very close there, not exactly a raging endorsement of Steve Scalise. To name Mr. Scalise their second ranking leader as his successor, him being Kevin McCarthy. Mr. Scalise turned back a challenge by Representative Jim Jordan of Ohio, the chairman of the Judiciary Committee and a favorite of the hard right who had the endorsement of former President Donald J. Trump. It continues on. After his slender loss, Mr. Jordan met with Mr. Scalise privately and offered to nominate him on the House floor, according to a spokesman, but he made no public statement of endorsement and his supporters did not appear swayed. So he still has to win a majority on the House floor. And just as a reminder, it took Kevin McCarthy 15 rounds to finally get the gavel. So he received 113 votes in the closed door meeting amongst just Republican members. He won't receive any votes from the Democrat members. As we know, it's very unlikely. And he is quickly, rapidly losing support amongst members of his own party, even amongst members who voted for him over Jim Jordan. Reminder, it takes 217 votes to become speaker, which means it takes only 8 Republicans in the House to prevent someone from becoming speaker. And it's looking like a lot more than 8 right now. It's looking like a hell of a lot more than 8 that are not going to vote for Steve Scalise. Now, this all took place yesterday. They are set to reconvene today, although there are no votes scheduled for today. It's very unlikely given the amount of meetings, individual meetings he's going to have to make with members of the caucus to try to sway them to vote for him, that they will be holding this today. Very unlikely. But a little bit more on the timeline. Mr. Scalise toiled Wednesday evening to try to win over his detractors, meeting one-on-one with several of them, but he appeared to be losing votes rather than gaining them. Representative Chip Roy, I'm sorry, it's such a ridiculous name that I laugh every time I read it. Representative Chip Roy, who engineered what he called a power-sharing agreement with Mr. McCarthy during his excruciatingly drawn-out election in January, pledged not to vote for Mr. Scalise. So Steve Scalise is going to be facing the same issue as Kevin McCarthy, maybe even to a greater extent as members of his party are vocally pledging not to support him. Mr. Roy said afterward, he wanted to see Mr. Scalise commit to changes demanded by hardline conservatives to how Congress operates. So let's talk about Steve Scalise, who once described himself as David Duke without the baggage, because I think his relationship to and his proximity with the establishment of the Republican Party has allowed him to frame himself as the more moderate candidate juxtaposed with Jim Jordan. There is no ideological difference that separates the two of them. They are both just as racist, just as homophobic. Their hearts are just as full of bigotry and their policy ideas are damn near identical. But it's just the rhetoric that surrounds them and the proximity, as I mentioned, to the establishment, to leadership within the party, that is the difference there. Now, about Scalise. Scalise has a history of being a staunch conservative who supports cutting government spending and implementing strict immigration policies and has long been a supporter of former President Donald Trump, though he is generally not considered a hard right firebrand like more recent prominent Republican additions to the House. Now, let's get into this a little bit, Jackson, because as I mentioned, Steve Scalise self-described as David Duke without the baggage. Obviously, for anyone who is unfamiliar, David Duke, former leader of the Ku Klux Klan. And we'll get a little bit more into Steve Scalise's proximity to white nationalism and how Republicans are using that to oppose him in a minute. But let's just talk about what this means for maybe the Republicans in swing districts who are going to face tough re-elections. They don't want to be represented by David Duke without the baggage or Jim Jordan, who pretends he doesn't see sexual abuse happening at Ohio State, right? This is a lose-lose for them, no matter who won. And Steve Scalise prevailing definitely, it doesn't benefit any of them.
Right, exactly. He's the Dave. He's just the more graceful, more smooth, more player version of David Duke that, you know, can just do a little better with more audience. But of course, that isn't true, as you pointed out. And, you know, I think it's important to remember, especially in special elections, Democrats have been outperforming in the poll than what they've shown in the polls. There was no red wave. You know, the Republicans narrowly took the House back, but they were supposed to sweep everything and they didn't. Donald Trump is looking more and more like a buffoon. He has almost 100 federal indictments. And actually, America's response to the conflict in Israel is making the Biden, you know, no matter how you feel about it, it's strengthening the Biden administration's look, because Republicans are very in favor of Israel, as are Democrats. But basically, kind of when you look at the whole thing in a sum, you know, it was ironic to see Newt Gingrich recently on Fox saying, you know, that these eight Republicans feel that they're more important than 96% of the Republican body. But so much of this was set in motion by Newt Gingrich himself. The culture that he created of owning the libs, of sticking it to the left, a lot of that was perpetrated by him. And so we're kind of looking at the death of what not just him, but that whole generation of Republicans created. I don't, you know, that's not to say that they're all, we're just going to get our acts together right away. But I mean, like, again, Republicans support Israel. Look at what Joe Biden is coming out in support of it. That is, it more and more, it's just looking good for the Democrats. And it's like, the more I think about it, again, the bottom line is the Republican Party is collapsing. They just are.
Absolutely. And right now, what those Republicans in swing districts that went for Biden that are facing these tough re-elections coming up in 2024 have to contend with is the fact that the longer this process is drawn out, the worse the Republican Party is going to look, yes, the worse it's going to reflect on them, the more cohesive the Democratic Party is going to look, because for better, for worse, they have their ducks in a row. They've been in lockstep throughout, you know, this entire process when it came to the budget resolution, the continuing resolution would pass, when it came to the first round of voting, when it was Kevin McCarthy, when it came to ousting Kevin McCarthy. They've been put together, again, for better, for worse. They've done a lot of things I disagree with, but the Republican Party has been in absolute disarray, which is going to reflect so poorly. Of course, it's not going to reflect poorly on Marjorie Taylor Greene, who's in like an R plus 75 district. It's going to look bad on the New York Republicans, who are facing, really the most vulnerable Republicans in their caucus are facing extremely tough battles from Democrats in this upcoming election.